Father, I want to bless you this afternoon. We want to share and to talk about a few things that are going to help us to disciple this nation. You commanded us in the Great Commission to go out and disciple nations. You want us to disciple Uganda, and one of the purposes of our being here is not only to refresh ourselves, but also to know and understand how effectively we can disciple this nation. As you've placed us in different places, our positioning, Lord God, is revealing to us your intent to help us, to enable us disciple this nation in the different fields where you've put us. Grant us light so that in your light we shall see light, and grant us revelation and understanding in your truth. In the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, we pray. When we we were discussing this with Maama Maria and Archbishop Orombi about these retreats, one of the things that we emphasized was to see how, as church leaders, as ministers of the gospel, we would be of help to you people who are in the marketplace. What can we do to support you, to serve you? How can we serve you better so that you, in your role of discipling this nation, will be effective? What is it that the church can do to make you more effective? Our purpose of being here is really to make you succeed, to see which areas we can support you with. Dale, can you please stand up again? This is my minister in charge of prayer, and I always told him I want to be with him here every retreat, because our purpose is really to pray for you, but we don't know many of you, and we don't normally interact. So when you come here, in case you have any area that you think we can help in the area of prayer to start with, where we can come in your department, in your institution, and offer prayer. We have a number of other pastors and prayer intercessors who are ready to stand with you in your department or wherever you are working, so that we can start prayer altars there. Suppose in Mukono you feel there is this and this, that I cannot handle it alone, I come back tired, I can't pray enough, and I need it. So we get to know that, and then we mobilize prayer around that particular need or particular area where you are. Does that make sense? So wherever you feel that you really need prayers, we are trying to get the church out of me, my need, my this, my want to start to make them see that there are other people who are in need of your prayers, rather than your own needs. There are people, brothers and sisters, in the marketplace who are serving God, and what they are doing is not their own thing. It is the kingdom of God. So when you serve them, God will also be blessing what you are doing. Seek ye first the kingdom, and your needs also will be made. So while he's here, and the days, the number of hours that you are here, please interact and let us know where we can be of help. Don't be shy, even if it's personal, because your success is also our success. If you fail, we all fail. If you succeed, we also succeed. When Robert succeeds, we know that there is a priesthood in the marketplace. When he fails, that priesthood has been affected. And another evil priesthood will arise and will not serve the purposes of the kingdom. When Maria succeeds here, we are now all succeeding, because now we have plenty of fresh air. We can go out and because her success is our success. So I wanted you to see him so that, can you turn around like an elephant so that he can see your face? So please, when you are here, it's part and parcel of the intentions for these retreats. First of all, to connect with God, reconnect, we are already connected, but refreshing our connection, then networking, to network so that we can come in and help you, stand with you. Also, you share your successes so that other people can say, oh, I see where I've been failing. Then let me maybe learn what she did, because after this we'll be hearing some testimonies of people who have learned something and gone and applied it, and it has worked. So that networking is very important. The people who are doing evil are networked. When you hear many billions swindled, it can't be one person. There's one in Bank of Uganda, another one in Ministry of Finance, another one in... So when they are networked and have that syndicate, they can get swindled these billions of money. It takes a team to do that kind of thing. But for us, the work is very great, but we are scattered, as Nehemiah said. The work we have to do to stop it is big. But we are what? Scattered. We don't know each other. We don't connect. And so the purpose of these retreats is to connect, to be able to connect and to link each other and say, okay, I know there is somebody now in the police. There's somebody now in the prosecution, in the DPP's office. There's somebody in the IGG's office. Well, last time when the last retreat, we had the DPP, Justice Chibita, was here with his wife. He may be coming in later because they have a meeting. They may be arriving tonight. But he said I was really, really very touched. And so he went back and said, I want to invite you. I'm going to call my senior management team for a retreat, and I want you to come and address us the way you addressed us here on some of the things that you dealt with, because that's exactly what my staff need. And he said some are Muslims, other are non-believers, they are just I think a couple of people who are born again, but you come and speak. So I went to Serena on the lake, you know that new Serena there. So I had 1.5 hours, and my approach there is not like the way I speak here. I speak to people knowing that some of them are not what? Believers. So the approach is a little bit different. But they liked it so much that after the meeting, they said, this is exactly what we need for all the directorate. You know that the Directorate of Public Prosecution is very big. They have 108 offices in the whole country, more than 5,000 senior lawyers and other junior lawyers. And they are the ones who handle all the prosecution. And that's where most of the corruption takes place. You are aware of that. And it's normally through that corruption that takes place with the prosecutors that cases are killed and all that kind of thing. So one of them who is in charge of the anti-corruption department said, I want you to start with my department because I want you to come. And I'm going to give my team 3 days so that you can come, speak with them. You just use the same outline, expand it. And, you know, they left very, very excited. And the DPP said, you know what? I have the money because they give me money for these workshops. But many of the workshops we've been doing have not been very what? Effective. So what we'll do, we'll go region by region. We go to one region, say Western. We go for 3 days, you come and we start to teach them the principles of God's word. You see, we can speak principles without quoting the source, and it still will be impactful because the word of God is like that. The word of God has attraction by itself. You speak the word of God, it has its own power. Even without quoting where you got it, it still has that power to change people. And so you imagine that this whole institution of the Directorate of Public Prosecution, what if we speak to these people and bring them to that level of understanding what it means when you're corrupt? What are the implications? And that's what I covered briefly, and you know, they were so happy about it, even Muslims and what? And said, now we are ready to roll that out, the whole country. I saw that as a big door being what? Open. How do you see that? Yeah? How do you see that? Now, some of you are similarly, our sister, your judge. Magistrate. Your magistrate, okay? Magistrate. Uh-huh. So what if we had another door opened in the judiciary in the same way, where we can have the same teaching brought and bringing out the principles and the implications of being unjust or, and then that's how you transform the nation. The soul of the nation are the attitudes and values of the people of the nation. The soul of the nation is changed by changing the soul, the attitudes, the interests, the values of the nation. In Psalms 19 verse 7, Bible says the word of God is perfect, converting the soul. So the word of God can convert a soul of the nation without necessarily people getting saved as such or saying I'm saved, but by understanding the biblical principles and inculcating into them the fear of God, the soul of the nation is what? Is changed. Here last week I was here with Dr. Yomoki. he brought the, how do you call them, the leaders of the workers, and the different workers. And I mean, they are big constituencies. One of them was a Muslim who has 25,000 teachers behind him. 25,000? Yeah, and others, another in the medical, and they have all these big, big, big constituencies. And this Muslim sat through the teaching and he said, what? He goes back and starts to, he finds his wife and says, praise the Lord. Now he's speaking it with the Lord. So his wife was wondering, are you saved now or what? But that's not important. You know, he was worried about these Muslims when he was calling me. He said, how will we handle the Muslims? I said, don't worry about Muslims. When we are teaching the word and explaining the principles, they will like it so much, you'll be surprised. So that's what I told him, and that's exactly what turned out. The Muslims liked it more than, because they have never had anything like it. These are principles that are timeless. They don't know religion. They don't know who you are. They are timeless principles, and when we learn them, we follow them. And that's what I want to summarize in these few minutes. Something about work, because all of us are either workers or have workers and us, okay? So I'm going to share a bit of what I shared with them, some of the headlines that I want. I'll not get as much time with you as I did with them, but I think these are principles that we need to learn. And because it's in teaching about work and principles, you disciple the nation. The nation transformed will result. One of the premier indicators that a nation has been transformed is the total breaking of that spirit of a curse of poverty. Poverty is one of the indications of how the spirits of lack and failure have managed to what? To cripple the nation. So it's a very, very important principle. So I'm going to say something about work and stewardship, because your work, your placement, your job is a stewardship from God. And as you do it and carry it out, you are supposed to be faithful. Amen? Okay, let's as I mentioned earlier, that these are laws. That's where I always start. These are laws that are timeless, like gravity. You know the law of gravity. Amen. Law of gravity does not segregate whether you're a Christian or a Muslim. Does it? No. And it doesn't this segregate about status, whether you're a bishop or a lay person. Even when you're Pope, if you step in the air, you'll fall and people say, no Pope are good. So, because of the gravity doesn't recognize the Pope, doesn't recognize anybody, whether a president or what. It's like the laws of reproduction, the laws of sowing and reaping, Newton's laws of motion, you know, those three laws of motion, the laws of demand and supply, those laws of thermodynamics. There are so many natural laws, as a scientist can tell you. These laws are the laws of nature, which Jeremiah 33:25 refers to as the laws of the natural laws. These laws, which we know, which we call the laws of science, are similar to those spiritual laws. The spiritual laws are like these laws of gravity. They are the same. To us, we call them natural, but for God, they are the same. Whether spiritual or natural or scientific, for God it's the same. To him, the law of sowing and reaping is exactly the same as the law of gravity. It's we who separated them, that now this is the natural law of gravity, but the law of sowing and reaping, for God it's the one and the same. They are all spiritual laws that govern his universe. And it is just absurd when people think that the world created itself, doesn't he? Why should the world obey laws when there is no lawgiver? You ask them, why would the sun every day obey that law of coming? Why should do gravity if there was nobody who commanded? It's like showing me a beautiful watch moving an elephant, and you say, no, it formed itself. It moves by itself. You see how it keeps time? It's by itself. There was nobody. It's just as stupid as that. How can something like a watch make itself? Yeah? You know, when you look at a human being, the complexity of our bodies, and you say, no, it's just formed by itself. Yeah? So that is this. But when we come into this, then we realize, really behind all these laws, they are orderly, they never miss. There is a lawgiver behind them. And that's why you start with, you know, people who don't even know God. Surely you can't find a watch and it's just made itself to move like that. And sometimes in science, when these laws are found out, people think that that's the day when they start. They have just discovered them. God has always been there. He made them, put them. Our science and the physics and whatever, it's just a mere discovery of them. Yeah? A mere discovery of them. The laws of mathematics result into the laws of physics, which result into the laws of chemistry, and then result into the laws of biology. And whatever we are is a result of all those laws which have always been in motion. And when you look at the first verse in the Bible, for instance, in the beginning God created the heavens and the earth. Yeah? When Einstein came with that formula of relativity, E is equal to mc squared, you know that formula, some of you are in physics and science. That law is just a discovery of what God had already said. In the beginning, what was the beginning? Time. Because before that, there was no time. It was eternity. So God created time. God created the heavens. And the heavens is space. And then the earth is what? Is matter. So that is what he found out, really. He's finding out what God had done. And many others, when you go deeper, you'll find all those laws. Now, what we are going to be doing in a few minutes is these laws, in the same way, they may not have a formula like this one, but they are also as much laws as these are in the area of work and what? And stewardship. So please, don't doze. Bear with me in a few minutes, and then we go through those few what? Those few laws. The first, I put them there. I always prefer that you do not need to have to write except what you don't see there, because these notes are sent to you. We email them to you on your emails once you give them to give us the email. So you don't have to write what you see. You only write what you want to add. Does that make sense? We are recording them. We are recording these sessions on video, so you can have the video, but also you'll have the notes, the outline. We'll send it on what? On your email. Yes. So you don't have to rewrite everything. Because I'm also a very jealous teacher. I want full attention, so that helps me to see your face, your beautiful faces, so that I keep encouraged that you are still here. You are not. So the number one, these are facts and benefits of work. I'm going through very quickly. Work was ordained by? God himself worked. The Bible says, for 6 days he worked. Then the seventh day he did what? Was there sin yet? No. Before sin, God worked. So work is not a what? A product of a sin, and it's not a curse. Work is not a curse, and it came, work started before the curse. So most people, and you may take that lightly, but many, many Christians and many think that work is a what? A curse. That, so we shouldn't, if I'm not working and I'm eating, I'm very blessed. No, that's totally wrong. So we have to correct that, whether we are supervising workers or ourselves are working. So work, we should see work as a very, very good thing, because it was ordained by what? By God. And you see, that is one of the things that God gave man. There are seven needs of man, and one of them is that need for significances, need for, and so for God to meet that need, he gave him work. I'll say a little bit more about that later on. Number two, it was the ground that God cast when man sinned. It was not work that he cast. What did he cast? The ground. God said the ground has been cast because of what? So God didn't even cast man. He did not cast, he cast the ground. Now, because it is in the ground that man was putting work to do, that's where work is also affected by that curse. But work itself is not a what? A curse. So the ground is what was cast. Now, because in the ground, God had already on the earth had established another law. In Genesis 8:22 is when he talks about it, but it had been there when he created the earth. What was the law? As long as the earth continues, seed time and harvest will not what? Cease. Meaning, when you put a seed in the ground, you reap, okay? Whatever you put in the earth, it gives you back. It doesn't give you the same quantities. It gives you a good measure. Press down, shaken together and running over. That is the command God gave to the earth. Every man who puts work in you, you should give him back a good measure, pressed down, shaken together and running over. That is in Luke chapter 6, verse 34, 37, 38. 6:38, Luke 6:38 is that law. You put work in the ground and give you back. If you put one seed in the ground, it should give you many more. When the ground was cast, the quantity now which comes out was affected. Before, it was a lot. But because of the fall, it was bringing now very what? Little. That's the difference. That now, what it gives out, that good measure, pressed down, shaken together, has been what? Affected and diminished. So that is a law of sowing and what? Reaping. But you also need to know that the same law applies in a negative way. If you, yes, it applies in the positive way. Whatever good thing that you put in the earth should be given back to you. But also the bad. You get it in the same what? Measure. The bad that you sow, you get it also in a good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over. So you get it also in the same way. So it's not just in the sowing of the good thing, but also the bad things. The number four is the physical strength. When God gave man work is a gift gave to man. It helps sustain our physical strength. It exercises our muscles and all that. That physical aspect. That's why we do exercises, to keep our bodies what? Moving. And he created us in such a way that when we exercise and we work, our bodies are sustained. That's how the optimal operation of the body will be. There are what? How many? 10 systems of the body. How many are they? 10? 9, 10. How many systems? The circulatory, respiratory, how many systems do we have? 8? No. About 10. Endocrine system, respiratory system, circulatory system, digestive. If you want all of them working together properly, you have to be what? To work, to stand. If they are not, then one of them will, you have this ease. Eh? Then there is the psychological part of it. This is a very important part also. It's a source of satisfaction and brings a sense of accomplishment. Every time God created in the 6 days, in the first 5 days, he says, it is good. 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 Then on the sixth day, what did he say? Very good. On the sixth day, it was different. You see what it brought? It brought a sense of? And a sense of? Yes. God knew you needed, you have that psychological need. That psychological need, when it is meant, you feel you are significant. We have a need for significance. Each one of us has a need for significance. So when he gives you work to do and you accomplish it after much effort, you feel accomplished. Do you know what we call that? Those who are accomplished. Why are they accomplished? They accomplished something. The people whom we call accomplished, he walked in a very accomplished manner. Because they have accomplished something, they feel proud of themselves, they're happy, they have a sense of satisfaction and sense of accomplishment. Even when you enter, you feel like people want to know, I'm here. You know, you don't mind people seeing you entering because you feel you are significant. People who have not accomplished anything and they are feeling nobody, when they come in, they hide at the back. Now, I'm not referring to these people to them sitting at the but these ones just sat there because the chairs here were. But others who are not here, when you've not accomplished anything, when you enter among people who have accomplished many things, you feel like a nobody. So you hide at the what? You don't even want them to know you are there, isn't it? But when you go and you're all, that day you feel good about yourself, you bought a beautiful dress. This is mainly our sisters. So when you come in, you see her eating the, you know, the whole way from the back of the church up to the front. And when they get to the front, you see them. Their problem is psychological. They want to tell everybody, Vanag, did you see me? I'm here. Did you see my dress? So there is a sense of So there is a need there in each one of us to feel that sense of what? Satisfaction and what? Accomplishment. When you have accomplished something, you feel your life has value. When you don't have it, you start to die. There's something that dies psychologically. It kills your faith, your sense of confidence. There's a lot that has affected. So God gave us work to meet that need. You feel that I'm doing something significant for the human race. I'm doing something significant for this village, for this city, for this nation. And when you have a good position and you're doing what you're supposed to do and people are praising you, you feel that sense of what? Accomplishment. And God gave us work for that. One of the reasons he did was that. The another number six is to sustain life. This is a very important one, that work helps us. How does it? In the book of Numbers chapter 20, one day, this is how the Lord told me this thing. I didn't know it, but it came like, I was reading the Bible in the morning, and then I came to that passage where God told Moses that Aaron's time has come to what? To die. Okay? So God told Moses, take Aaron up the mountain, but before you take him, dress him up in his full attire as a high what? Priest. So he put in Aaron everything about his high priesthood. So they went up the mountain. Moses, Aaron, and Eleazar, the son of Aaron, who was going to replace Aaron. So then God told Moses, take one piece at a time. Take one piece from Aaron to Eleazar, one at a time. So he continued removing one until the last one. The Bible says when he removed the last bit and put it on Eleazar, Aaron fell, died. He died. And so one morning I was praying and saying, hey. So I never noted this, but then the Lord just brought this clearly to me, that our life here on earth is sustained by the ministry and the assignment he gave you. The moment you stop fulfilling that assignment, you start to die. You may be there physically, but you start to die every time you stop. That was a big shock to me. So while I'm in the assignment that God gave me, and I'm fulfilling it,